Good evening. My name is Daryl Jabin. I'm called Oregon's Traveling Historian. That's actually something that I made up. I have a job during, prior to COVID, actually, I traveled around the state of Oregon. I traveled at least 6,000 miles, and I worked in 24 cities, and I found it was a lot more fun to find out about Oregon and Oregon history than it is to sit in a motel room and see if there's something interesting on television. So, and I know we're missing the football game, but oh well. We are going to try to wrap this up in about 45 minutes. Hopefully that'll give us plenty of time and give time for questions as well, because we are doing live, and I do understand that the bathrooms actually close at 8 o'clock, just to make sure you're aware of that as well. The state parks are celebrating 100 years this year. And actually this particular presentation is because of a antique auto club down in Salem. I have done a presentation for them in the past, and they asked me to do one again, and I gave them a couple of option choices, and one of the ones I said, well, we're going to be celebrating 100 years of the state parks. Do you want to do that one? And they said, sure, let's do that one. And then they postponed the presentation. But I did do it for them, and they felt kind of bad about that, actually. But I said, you know, I'm sure I'll be able to use it, and I've actually done it about a dozen times for retirement homes and other folks throughout the state. I do plenty of presentations. I've done actually more than 300 presentations. I started doing YouTube videos years ago, and my YouTube channel now has more than 100,000 views. And my Facebook page, I have 5,500 people that follow my Facebook page. I do post 3 times a week, so you're certainly welcome to take a look at those. So plenty of things about Oregon to share. And of course, plenty to share about Samuel Boardman and state parks as well. Samuel Boardman was not only the namesake of Boardman, Oregon, actually he and his wife platted the town, but also he was our first state park superintendent. And so he had quite a bit to do with our state parks. This is our biggest, more than 9,000 acres, not far from here, Silver Falls Park. Has 10 waterfalls and miles of trails. I think somebody was saying that they got lost in some of those trails. Not hard to do, I've got to imagine. So, and actually it was because of Mr. Boardman. It was one of his first acquisitions as far as the state park system. But it was also because of a photographer in Silverton. There's a gentleman by the name of June Drake that for a number of years was advocating for that to be a state park. So that's why it became a state park. And one of those 10 waterfalls is named for him. So there is Drake Waterfall in the park. Mr. Boardman actually was born in 1874. He was not born in Oregon. He came to Oregon in 1903. He was working his way to the West as a young man and was a railroad engineer and then tried farming, dry land farming, did it for 12 years and went broke. So he found, you know, have to have something to do. And so he joined the state highway department. And he did plat the city of Boardman. If you've gone up 84, you've probably seen the water tower up there. And if you got off the freeway, off the highway, you'll see the Boardman there. And there were a few things that led up to the interest in parks. This is what I consider the most important historical event in Oregon history. And why do I say that? It's because it drew more than 1.5 million paid admissions to that in 1905. People in Portland thought that they were as good as anywhere. And how do you get the word out? Let's have a state or a fair. It wasn't technically a World's Fair. It was actually a private enterprise called the Lewis and Clark Centennial, American Pacific Exposition, and Oriental Fair. They added Oriental Fair for tax breaks. Because it was, it was a private enterprise, and so they got tax breaks for promoting trade with the Orient. And they had 21 countries and 18 states that participated in it. And here's what it did, and here's why I say it's the most important historical event. Take a look at our population in 1890, 317,000. We were on a growth spurt there. 1900, we had 413,000. But look after the fair. Went up to 672,000, and in the 1920s, 783,000. So it had a huge impact on our state, and a lot of cities were incorporated at that point in time. We see a lot of buildings around the state because of that, and of course, more people moving here. That was the idea of, and so people had an interest in what's in Oregon. Actually, the Oregon Blue Book started about that time too. People are familiar with the Oregon Blue Book. We also had getting us out of the mud. There were actually a group of people called Good Roads Committee. They did meet at the Lewis and Clark Exposition, and they said, we need to start building roads because otherwise you have a whole bunch of muddy area. So let's get Oregon out of the mud. And we did a couple of things. They created the Oregon State Highway Department, 1913. 1919, we were the first in the nation to use tax on gasoline to fund our roads. And actually, that's the way a lot of states do that. They use tax on gasoline to do so. And I did find Jackson County was the first county that had border-to-border roads. I'm guessing it was because of the fruit industry. You have Harry and David down there. If you want fruit to get to market without having a bunch of bruises, it makes sense to pay for roads. That's my supposition. Could be different, but that's why I think they were the particular ones that had that first. We did have a couple other things. Columbia River Highway. These two gentlemen, this is actually a statue out in Troutdale that I came across one day. I travel around and do just take little places off and sound, hey, there's a statue there. Let's take a look and find out what that is. Sam Hill and Sam Lancaster, they saw the wonderful scenic highways in Europe and said, we can do that here. We have the wonderful Columbia Gorge. And they stood up what's now Portland Women's Forum. It's a state park above Vista site there. And that's where actually there was an inn at that time. And they said, we have this plan to put together the highway all along the Columbia and make a wonderful scenic area all along. And a lot of that is parks these days. We also had the state beaches. Oswald West, Governor Oswald West, 1913. Reinforced by Governor Tom McCall in 1967. Make sure where the line was and where beaches were. But we did make them a state highway. And that's actually where a lot of communities got that they used the state highway, the beaches, in order to get from place to place. Because we didn't have Highway 101 at the time. We did have some wonderful bathing suits. This is actually a picture I found that belonged to the Bush House Museum in Salem. I like that bathing suits back in the time. So Mr. Boardman, as I said, he failed as far as being a farmer, dryland farmer, so he was hired by the Oregon State Highway Department in 1919. He was not hired to be parks person yet. He planted shade trees, and actually he always liked doing that. Planting trees along the highway to make it a more scenic type of area. So he planted shade trees, and then he was in charge of doing roads in southern Oregon. In 1929, he was promoted to the first state park superintendent. And over his 21 years in office, he built it from 46 units to 161 units. We now have over 250 parks in the state, over 100,000 acres. And they count for 50 million visits, day visits per year. Now, some of those are people that just stop off and use the restroom. But that counts that they're using a state park. So 50 million state park visits per year. 4,000 acres to 60,000 acres in that time period. 1929, we had a national depression. So we didn't have money. So how did he go about acquiring land? This is one of his logbooks. Actually, the State Archives has boxes of his belongings. And I went down, took a picture of one of them. That's hard to read, so I'll make it a little easier. January 1932, this is his weekly report. He was in McMinnville in Newburgh on the 18th. 19th, he was back in his office and then went up to Hood River. The 20th, he was back in his office and went to Silver Falls Park. The 21st, he drove down to Bandon, southern Oregon coast. Stayed over in Bandon and Marshfield. Marshfield is Coos Bay now. They did change the name. And Reedsport, Eugene, and Salem. He was personally knocking on doors to tell people that they should give us land. 500,000 miles is what he traveled in that 21 years. And that's why we have a lot of parks that are named for individuals. From a historian standpoint, that's a little annoying. because you try to find the name of somebody and say, why is this person famous? Why do they have a park? The only reason they have a park is because they gave the park to the state, which is nice. They are part of Oregon history that way because of Mr. Boardman. But he managed to give them the property inexpensively and build that wonderful park system that we have today. Actually, the first park was not a state park. It was given to the public in 1871. Actually, this was because the archives, they told me this particular thing. Sotaville. It did become a state park. It was Sotaville Springs State Park for a while. And then it changed to a city park in 1972. They did have, of course, mineral springs and quite a good interest in springs and people bathing in springs. So it was kind of a resort area down there at one point in time. Actually, my understanding is the first person that found the springs tasted it and laid down to die because he thought it tasted so terrible, he must have been poisoned. And I can imagine if anybody's tasted lithium water down in Ashland, it tastes terrible. That's terrible stuff. Fortunately, he didn't, and they created the city. And here's why it got changed back to the city, is because it's right in the middle of the city. So it's not a surprise that it became part of the city of Sotaville. Sotaville's not a big city. Actually, I had to find out for certain if it was incorporated. So I looked it up and actually found out the P.O. box that's used for the city hall is actually in Lebanon rather than in Sotaville. The first one that was given to the state for the state was Helmick Park. And this is about halfway between Monmouth and Corvallis, right off of Highway 99. And I sometimes work at a Dare Village down there. And I saw the sign quite a few times and I decided, well, I probably should hop over there and take a look and see what Helmick Park is like. So I did, and it was actually given to the state of Oregon in 1922, 100 years ago. February 15th, and it was given by Sarah Helmick. That's why it's called Helmick Park. Her son and daughter-in-law gave the first 5 acres. It's actually now 30 acres. But her and her husband traveled the Oregon Trail back in 1846, and then 76 years later, Grandma Helmick, as she was called, decided to give the land to the state of Oregon. My understanding is people did actually camp there before it was given as a state park. But was given as an auto park because they had plenty of places that were auto parks because people traveled, but we didn't have the travel that we do today. It isn't quite as reliable, and so people had to camp overnight, didn't travel as far as fast, so they had to be overnight, and they did stay at Helmick Park. Now it's just a nice park to have a picnic at. And actually, the car club that I talked to was going to be part of the celebration there for 100 years of parks. And I did find you can learn all kinds of Oregon history through our parks, those 250 parks that we have. Millions of years ago, this area was underwater. I was being told about the mastodon here. We do have all kinds of history, and we were underwater at one point in time. Then those plates underneath our surface pushed up and caused volcanoes. And Smith Rock, wonderful climbing rock now by Redmond, but it was volcanic in nature. And Fort Rock, southeast of Bend, actually was not only volcanic, but also was where they found the world's oldest shoes. Dr. Luther Crespin, University of Oregon professor, was uncovering some of the Mazama dust, actually volcanic ash, and found the world's oldest shoes there. Yeah, more than 10,000 years old. You can find those at the Natural and Cultural Museum at University of Oregon. The shoes are there. I did find we do have two volcanoes within cities. There's only four in the United States, two of them in Oregon. One is a city park, Mount Tabor, and the other is in Bend. And this was a cinder cone. It was given actually to the state because they were honoring a businessman who passed away, Terrence Foley. Friends of his gave this particular property to the state of Oregon. And it is called Pilot Rock, Pilot Butte rather, because it was used by Native Americans. They would go up the mountain and could point to where the game was that they were hunting for the other tribe people. And people who were traveling the Oregon Trail could stay on track by saying, well, there's Pilot Butte. Where do we need to go from there? Or they could hike up to the top of it and see where to go from the top of it. And actually, they have made the top very nice. Actually, they've got a nice directional spot. There aren't too many big buildings in Bend, so you have a wonderful view. Let's not say anything against Bend. So, but you have a wonderful view of the entire area. And fortunately, because of this, you can identify what those mountain ranges are. And there's a nice picture of that. Three sisters. I was in Bend last week. I meant to get up there. I didn't do that. I've been up to the top. That actually is my picture of the other part. A lot of these pictures are from the state parks system. They do have wonderful pictures of a lot of their state parks. So we had volcanic activity. 20,000 years ago, we had the floods. And I understand people here are well familiar with that. The Missoula floods, there was ice on where Missoula, Montana is now. It melted, came down through the Columbia Gorge, and left behind erratic rocks. There's actually erratic rock at Clackamas Community College. There's one at Willamette University. The Willamette meteorite could be considered that. Of course, it's not here anymore. It's in a museum in New York. But there, we did make a park called Erratic Rock Park. And this was actually a 90-ton erratic that traveled 500-plus miles. So I've never been to this park, but they say the thing to do there is go and just marvel about the fact that something that big traveled with that kind of water power to that particular place. I don't know if there's anything else to see there, but I'll get there. Not much, okay? That's what I was kind of thinking. So I haven't been really thrilled about going to see that. We did, of course, have human activity in parks, too, and we do recognize that. Shampooey Park, not far from here. And this was that vote in May 5th, 1843. We weren't a state yet. There was still a question of whether we're going to be part of Great Britain or part of the United States. And they got people together and they said, well, who's in favor of being part of the United States? Joseph Meek said, all those in favor, step across this line. And 52 people voted in favor of the United States. That's not definitely one of the things that said that we became a part of the United States, but that was one of those things that were pivotal in far as emphasis goes towards becoming part of the United States. And I did run into a parks ranger who does repeat this. He does talk about that particular presentation in front of people at the park, at Shampooey, and he draws a line in the sand, and he says, all those in favor of the United States, come on over, step across the line. And he says he gets a lot of kids that are kind of apprehensive about it. And so he leans over and says, come on, kids, I want to keep my job. This became a state park in 1901. The last person that was from that vote in 1843, Mr. Matthau, said, I think this is where it was. That vote was taken. And they did put up that nice little monolith type. And they do have, every year they invite the descendants of those 52 people to come and have a little ceremony. Yeah, so you can go see that ceremony every year if you wish. This person here actually is descendant of the Wilsons. The Wilsons actually owned the property. They worked for the Methodist missionaries. And they owned the property. They were given property from the donation land claims where the state capitol and Willamette University are today. To the west of the state capitol is called Wilson Park, named for them. Actually, she's been involved and her family's been involved in Oregon history for a number of generations. Her dad did a book on Dr. John McLaughlin, and he had a picture of Dr. John McLaughlin in the house. She was too young to recognize who he was. She thought he was a crazy uncle. Her younger brother thought he was God. So he's kind of an imposing figure, so I can understand that. But they do have this, and actually this is something I went to a couple years ago, and so I did take some pictures, and they did put them on a couple of websites as well. This was actually another important part of Oregon history. It's actually one of our smallest parks. 1851, and anybody who's owned property in Oregon or Washington has been impacted by that particular spot. When we started becoming organizations who are territorial government, we started saying, well, we have to measure where those property lines are. So you have to have some spot to measure them from. This is the spot in the West Hills of Portland. And actually, there isn't much else to this park. There's a little walkway down to it. You walk down and you see where that particular spot is. There was a stone, I understand, at one point in time, but now we have a nice metal spot, where the Willamette Meridian. And from east to west, it was baseline in Hillsboro. And there was one in Portland, too. It's now Stark Street. There's actually markers every so many miles. You can see those markers along Stark Street. You can find them still, a number of them. North-south was the Willamette Meridian. There's Meridian, Oregon, along the Meridian. Makes sense.
The Meridian line is right by the hospital in here.
Okay.
Meridian Park. Less than a mile away.
Meridian Park Hospital. There we go.
67.
Thank you. 67? Okay.
65.
See, I learned things too. So thank you. We did, of course, have our history on things that impacted our history as far as logging goes and a number of other industries. The Collier family actually was down in Klamath Falls and were involved in the lumber business. Their sons actually gave Collier Park, which is north of Klamath Falls, to the state. And it is a wonderful collection of old logging equipment. So you can find 100 years of logging history just by going through. They have cabins, they have old equipment, they have high wheels. If people aren't familiar with high wheels, you put lumber under there and you pull this down and connect them. They used to connect them to oxen. They found out oxen with horns are not quite as desirable as doing horses. So they switched to horses instead. But we did have steam engines in order to move out logs as well. And they have had in the past, I don't know if they're doing this again, I could check and find out, a history day, which is wonderful because then they have enactors to show what kind of things are done as far as the lumber industry goes. We did have ranching in Eastern Oregon, the Peter French Round Barn. Do you know why it's a round barn? Okay. Yeah, they exercise the horses. The other part, and this is one something I didn't think about, but somebody said, you know why it's a round barn? I said, no. They said they trained wild horses. If you have a wild horse, you don't want to be cornered by it. You can't be cornered in a round barn. You have some way to escape from that horse. So it makes some sense. Yeah, Peter French Round Barn. We have, actually there's about a dozen lighthouses. And Hacienda Head actually is a bed and breakfast run by, well, it's run by private people, but it's the state owned. And you can actually stay in the assistant lighthouse keeper's cabin, as I understand, as a bed and breakfast on it. My understanding, the first lighthouse that we built actually fell into the water. Oops, yeah. And we did have mining. Actually, there were mining in a number of places. John Day had mining. Baker City had mining. Jacksonville had mining. Actually, I understand Jacksonville and Southern Oregon, they had miners probably both from California and Oregon. Tax collectors would come and they'd say, no, no, we're all from the other state, basically. And say, California tax collectors came. They said, we're from Oregon. Oregon tax collectors came and said, no, no, we're from California. So try to get out of those. But we did have just a dredge. Actually, this was one of three, and they operated for 20 years dredging gold out of there. Of course, when you get all the gold done, what do you do with this big, huge machine? You give it to the state so they can show people what that was like. So these are heritage sites on some of the impact of different economies, different businesses over time. Closer to gold, actually John Day area, This was probably an outpost, a fort, and that was sold to two Chinese gentlemen who were very well respected both by the Chinese community as well as others. And they operated as a pharmacy and community center for decades. And then when the last individual passed away, the last of those two individuals, he gave it to his nephew, and the nephew gave it to the state intact. So all those herbs and medicines that they had are still there. So you can take a look and see exactly what it was like when they were operating that particular way. I actually volunteer at the, or have in the past, at the Museum of the Oregon Territory in Oregon City, and they actually were given a pharmacy. So they have a bunch of pharmacy bottles there. The interesting thing is there's not expiration dates on them. I don't know about the potency on those. Are they worse or better? Or the same? Actually, I did notice they do have placebo pills there too, just in case. I don't know if they had placebo pills there. Cam Hua Sheng actually means Golden Chinese Outpost. So that's, I think, was part of the state park system. We do have the Thompson's Mills. There was a community named Boston. You don't hear about it because it changed. Actually, they started in the mid-1800s. It burnt first, and then they rebuilt it. And they platted an area, and then the trains came. Trains don't want to alter from their course. Went through Albany, went through Tangent, and they went through Shedd. And so when they built the city of Shedd, because of the railroads, people got their houses together and moved them elsewhere. I understand they don't have the foundations at the time, so it's a little easier to move the houses to different places. But that's why you don't hear about it. But it was a community in Boston, and it was flour mill for a number of decades, actually early 1900s during World War I. They were busy 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, because they were making flour for our allies. They found out flour wasn't profitable, so they did switch to animal feed. They did animal feed for a number of years, and then when it last was operating, they were just selling the electricity back to the utilities because they do operate it by water power. And you can go down there and see it. They do have volunteers who stay on the property, and they will give you tours through the whole thing. They'll show the electricity part, and they'll open the waterways and show that water coming through to power the mill. And a lot of the mill belongings were left when they left the building. They just gave it intact and said, here it is. Actually, it spent the state 2 years just to make sure it was a safe building because they didn't spend a lot of money in making sure it was nice. Actually, my understanding, they didn't have women there till years later, so the bathroom facilities were a little crude. I'll just leave it at that. We did have one of the longest operating inns. It's still in operation, built in 1883. This was probably built for a stagecoach stop. They thought maybe trains, but actually trains were a little further away from that, but probably stagecoach did stop there. And it is still in operation as a restaurant and bed and breakfast. It's run by private individuals, but you can stay there. And actually, famous people did years ago. Jack London stayed there. Orson Welles, Clark Gable, and Carol Lombard all stayed there. So you can stay where they did. There's some other reasons for our state parks. Southern Oregon coast is one of the few places in the world, I've heard that there's the Holy Lands too, I'm not positive of that, but where they grow myrtlewood. So there were a few folks, including the wife of the person of Jackson, who ran the Oregon Journal, publisher of the Journal, his wife, and I can't think of her name on hand, unfortunately, but she was involved in this particular effort to save those particular properties. There's actually four parks that were put together, that were purchased by the Save the Myrtlewood group. Save the Myrtle. So these are those particular spots. And as I said, they did do it to acquire a few desirable groves of outstanding Oregon myrtle trees and dedicate them to public benefit. Myrtlewood is unique in that it pulls the minerals from the soil, and so the wood is different depending on where it grows. And that's why it comes out with these wonderful colors that it does. Yeah, didn't know that. Mr. Boardman, last acquisition he had was along the coast. Actually, a lot of the things that he wanted just scenic areas. He didn't believe in making it a really nice area. Some of the properties were helped build by the Civilian Conservation Corps, actually Silver Falls. There was a Civilian Conservation Corps camp there that built a number of the bridges and walkways in that particular park. And my understanding is Mr. Boardman wanted to make sure that he was in charge of making sure what they did, that he approved all those. He was kind of controlling in that respect. But he did go along the Oregon coast, and it was 12 ocean-hugging miles along the coast, and we did name that particular property for him. It's north of Brookings, Samuel Boardman Scenic Corridor. Back in the 1950s, we had people coming back from the war. They're starting families. They wanted to get out and see areas. So we had a big push from the Transportation Department, and Douglas McKay, who was governor, promoted parks. He actually became an interior secretary under Eisenhower later on. He was a mayor of Salem. Actually, he was an auto dealer first, mayor of Salem, and then governor of our state of Oregon. We have Douglas McKay High School in Salem. So we did have camping and did have people out there enjoying the park. This always reminds me of some 1950s science fiction picture. Women taking over Mars or wherever it was, you know. Because it's all women. No men in there. I don't know what they did with the men, but this is in Hug Park. Hug Park is south of Cannon Beach, and this is why it was called Hug Park. Because it hugs right there. Yes. Remember, this is the way people got from place to place years back. We didn't have Highway 101. So this is the way they had to get there. And there is the Oregon Geographic's name book, and the author writes about Hug Point. And his comment in regards to that was that, frankly, he'd rather drown than be scared to death. I can understand it.
And that road still exists.
That road still exists?
Yeah.
Okay.
We've been there.
All right. You didn't drive it, did you?
No.
Okay. It's submerged at high tide? That doesn't surprise me either. This, I thought, was an interesting part of Oregon history because years back, Eugene had a huge pageant. They did it at the football stadium. Actually, not the current football stadium, the one that's used for track purposes now, Hayward Field. And they had thousands of people involved in it. And the idea was to celebrate the fact that we had changed over the years from the Oregon Trail to trains. So it was trails to rails. Well, we actually have as much train traffic as was ever had as far as moving things back and forth, but they don't have that same impact on those small communities, and they don't need it in those small communities because we have roads and cars and trucks and all those type of things to take things on a short distance. So what do you do with those old roads? You make them into trails. So this is Banks to Vernonia State Trail. It is 21 miles long, and we've gone from trails to rails to rails to trails. Switch from one to the other. And that's actually, I did not walk this or bike it. I understand it's actually a pretty easy bicycle ride because it's pretty flat. But fortunately, there are spots there you can stop, or you can take a car from place to place. So that's what I did, just took a car and took some pictures along the way there. Not along the path. I wasn't driving along the path. There's a close by road that stops along those, just so you know. And one of our most recent acquisitions actually changed over. It wasn't an acquisition because it's been a park. I said Wilson Park is actually right here, this side of the Capitol building, the west of the Capitol building. We do have two other parks, one to the north, which is right there, with the Sprague Fountain. The Sprague Fountain was given by Governor Sprague. We also have a high school name for him. He was local editor of the newspaper and was one-term governor and gave money to the state to provide a gift for the people of Oregon. So that's why we have that wonderful fountain. Actually, not everybody thinks it's a wonderful fountain. Somebody told me recently that Governor Attia wanted to get rid of it. He didn't particularly like that. It's not one that kids can play on, unfortunately. But this was not made, this was made into a state park in 2008. It was established as a state park. So one of our more recent acquisitions, as I said, changes to state park. So we've had lighthouses. Actually, we're going to end up a little bit early here. That one says 20 till, but we'll see. Actually, I suppose we could have time for questions as well. We still do have plenty of lighthouses. That's the one I mentioned, Portland Women's Forum. You see these wonderful pictures of the gorge and of Vista House, is it? From that particular point. Yeah, it's Portland Women's Forum. Used to be an inn there, and that's actually, as I said, Sam Lancaster and Sam Hill were the people that were looking over that. They were looking at same area and saying, we need to build this wonderful road in the Columbia Gorge. And Silver Falls Park. And that is my story about Oregon Park. Thank you.